Good afternoon and welcome to Nasdaq Trade Talks. I'm your host, Jill Malandrino, Global Markets Reporter at Nasdaq. It's Friday at the MarketSite. That means we have my partner in crime, Chris Dearborn, on Nasdaq's Markets Intelligence Desk for the weekly review from the mid. And what a week it was for you guys. You had earnings, you had the FOMC, you've had Trade Talks, you have everything going on, all to make it the strongest January for the U.S. markets nearly 30 years.
It's really a risk-on environment for traders. Investors are getting a great return for their buck if they've been invested during the month. And the markets went out at the highs for yesterday. We had great, decent volume trading-wise, averaged about 7.5 billion shares a day, which shows you that it's above average. But yesterday's volume was the highest we've seen for the entire year so far of 2019, topping 9 billion shares on tape. That's telling you that people are getting involved into the markets after that horrendous Q4 that we saw at the end of the year,
right,
especially in December.
I would say a lot of it's attributed to the FOMC response.
Yep, you've got exactly, that's exactly it. You know what, Jay Powell put a very patient, dovish statement out there, followed it up with a very interesting press conference, mm-hmm. using the word patient over and over and over again. What that's really proving us is that the Fed is not going to be an issue for investors, at least for the near term.
The Powell put.
Pretty much. That's what we're looking at. I really think that what you're going to see there is that's this one building block that's kind of put back in place here that traders don't have to worry about. And you've got a number of different items to worry about when we're in the thick of earnings. You've got a situation down in Washington, D.C. You've got China and the U.S. trade talks. And there's a whole number of other items out there that people to worry about. The FOMC is not one of those items anymore.
Well, employment's not either, apparently. That non-farm payrolls report this morning, wow.
It's a blockbuster number. It's the best number in 11 months. Well over 300,000 when you're only looking for 165,000 new ads. The flip side of it was that December's number, which was also a blockbuster number, well over 300,000, was reduced down by 90,000 jobs. So there's some seasonality in there, and which is to be expected, but not to that effect. So regardless, what you're showing is that the government shutdown is not having any immediate impact on the labor market, which is good. And it's also, it's good for consumers, it's good for retail, it's good for GDP, even though we're hoping that we'll make up what we've lost so far in Q1 here, moving forward, and we should. People going back to work, people putting to work, even though the unemployment number ticked up to 4%, which is a little bit higher than we wanted to see, that had some impact on it, but not a lot. So wages tick up a little bit as well. All good numbers. I think we're okay here.
All right. What are some of the earnings themes that you're seeing emerge for the season?
Earnings have been a mixed bag. Remember, we had lower guidance mm-hmm. coming into December. A lot of companies lowered. Apple was one of them and everything else, but then Apple knocks out of the park. Facebook got beat up. Facebook came out strong. Was one of the best performers of the week. Amazon comes out and they just have one of the best quarters ever. They're making money hand over fist. But investors, because of their guidance numbers, are putting Amazon to the task today, down 4%. So what is that telling you? You're being rewarded for your future guidance and what you think you're going to make as opposed to what you have made and how well you have responded. And that's where the current sentiment is. And that will continue as the theme going forward until it doesn't work anymore.
All right, let's look at the trading week ahead, the State of the Union, February 5th. I'm sure that's going to be a big part of the conversation next week. Earnings, some data, a couple Fed speakers here and there, but curious to see how the market, if it gets any reaction at all from the State of the Union.
It's, again, more political hand-wringing. Fortunately for the market, politics has not shaken itself down into the marketplace. Traders and investors have kind of looked through that and realized it for what it is. It's just political handshaking at each other, and people position themselves for 2020. And more importantly, what we're looking at is what the Fed speakers have to say, mm-hmm. if they're going to reiterate the Powell statement from the other day. Also, you got over 100 S&P 500 companies reporting, some of the big boys, Google, mm-hmm. Disney. You've got a number of different biotechs coming out. You're going to start bleeding into the more retail names as we go forward. You've got a significant amount of items, especially that can impact certain sectors, that could be a broad impact to the market as a whole. And that's what we have our eyes
on. All right. Well, it'll be interesting to see what our conversation is next week, but with our new Trade Talks rebranding and the mid officially on our team. So lots to look forward to next week. Thank you, as always, my friend, for joining
me.
And thank you for joining me throughout the week. I'm Jill Malandrino, Global Markets Reporter at Nasdaq.